I think we can resume our meeting now. We will first invite the officials to join us for the third item. The third item on the agenda is the toll rationalization study of the three road harbour crossings and the three land tunnels and the preliminary findings. I believe many members would like to speak on this item. Please press the button if you want to speak. We have 12 members. Right. I believe many members are interested in this topic. I have also received a motion moved by a member, which we will need to deal with later on. So I'm going to exercise my power as chairman to extend the meeting by 15 minutes. So I propose that each member be given 4 minutes. We'll start with the Undersecretary. Please walk us through the paper. Thank you. Today, we're here to report to members in respect of the preliminary findings of the toll rationalization study of the three road harbour crossings and the three land tunnels and the way forward. The study, we have the study because government earlier on, the government had undertaken to, in respect of the three road harbour crossings, to conduct a study on the toll rationalization. According to the TD's assessment in respect of the three road harbour crossings and the three land tunnels, namely the Eagle's Nest and Sharding Heights Tunnel, Lion Rock and Tate's King Tunnel, the TD conducted a study this year covering the six tunnels, using a fair manner to through the adjustment upward and downward of the tolls to encourage drivers to use tunnel with capacity which have not yet been saturated. The study is based on building a transport model to adjust the, by adjusting the model we will project the different scenarios of different tolls and what the driver's preference would be, and also to assess the impact of any adjustment on toll fees. Since the toll fees could, there could be different combinations of toll fees, we need to come up with a solution that can help rationalize the distribution of the usage of these tunnels. And therefore, we propose that when we will incorporate the views of stakeholders and members, and then we will work out the proposals of the different tolls, and then consider the impact of the different options. We will, within this legislative session, consult the views of members further. With that, I'll ask our colleagues from the TD to report to members on the preliminary findings. I'd like to remind members, well, members already should have read the paper, so when the TD, you know, walk us through the paper, please be as brief as you can. I'm going to brief members on the preliminary findings of the toll rationalization study for the three cross harbour tunnels and the three land tunnels. As members can see, this is the traffic situation for the tunnels at the moment. During the peak hours in the morning and late afternoon, the situation is reflected in the PowerPoint. The red line represents the peak hours in the morning. The late afternoon peak hour is blue. As the gas coin fly over during the morning peak hours, you'll find that the queue is 2.9 kilometers. In the late afternoon, along Connor Road, going it's 3 kilometers. Next, for the land tunnels, you know, linking up Kowloon with Sha Tin, again, the situation is like that. The red line stands for the morning peak hour, as you can see. For the Lion Rock Tunnel, it's about 1.8 kilometers. The Tate's King Tunnel is about 1.9 kilometers. We've also, based on these figures, we've prepared this table. We can see for the East Harbour crossing, whether it's in the morning peak hour or in the late afternoon, it takes about 14 minutes. For the Cross Harbour Tunnel, it's about half an hour. For the Western Harbour Crossing, it's about 3 minutes. For the Tate's Cairns Tunnel, the peak hours in the morning and the late afternoon. In the morning, it's 26 minutes. And for the Lion Rock Tunnel, it's around 15 minutes. For Route 8, it's like the Western Harbour Crossing. The traffic volume is not really that large. And we've also compared the actual traffic volume and the design capacity. During the morning peak hours, both southbound in the morning and northbound traffic in the late afternoon, we've already exceeded the design capacity. Despite it, however, the total traffic demand both ways is smaller than the total capacity. Let's take a look at what the situation will be like in 2021. Again, it will be similar to what we saw earlier. In the morning peak hour, the southbound traffic, the traffic demand, and also the northbound traffic in the late afternoon, it's already exceeded the present capacity. There have been various proposals for adjusting the tolls, and we've considered the various proposals covering the proposal to reduce the toll for the East Harbour Crossing to align with the Cross Harbour Tunnel. Tate's Cairns Tunnel, we will lower the toll fees, and thirdly, increase the toll for the Harbour Cross Tunnel and lowering the East Harbour Crossing. The third option is lowering the toll for the East Harbour Crossing and the Cross Harbour Tunnel, and increasing them and lowering the fee for the West Harbour Crossing. If we lower the toll for the East Harbour Crossing and the Tate's Cairns Tunnel, it will not improve the situation for Lion Rock and the Cross Harbour Tunnel. If we were to waive all the tolls, it will generate additional demand, and it will further, aggravate the traffic congestion. Thirdly, the adjustment for the tolls should be based on the premise that we should make use of the spare capacity of the Lion's Nest and tunnel, and also the West Harbour Crossing. Regarding the study on how to rationalize the traffic flow, we've already looked at the traffic distribution of six tunnels in order to come up with the mechanism for adjusting the tolls for the six tunnels in order to rationalize the distribution traffic flow. The consultant is now working on the traffic data model in order to predict what the traffic situation will be like under different toll charge scenarios. Previously, there have been various proposals for toll adjustments, which I really touched on earlier. If we were to adopt all the proposed adjustments in 2021, the queue will be further extended. This will affect about 2 million people every day. The social cost, therefore, is very high. I also like to mention that the auto toll channels for the tunnels. At the moment, we have traffic congestion mainly because the vehicle flow or volume has already exceeded the intended capacity of the tunnels, and therefore the vehicles are like tunnels filtering into the tunnel. Increasing the number of auto tolls or applying electronic road pricing will not increase the capacity, and therefore will not help relieve the traffic congestion. I'd also like to talk about the toll in respect of the Western Harbour Crossing. For private vehicles, it's $65, taxi $60. We've already listed the fees here. What I'd like to point out is that the Western Harbour Crossing is owned by a franchisee, and the franchise will expire on the 2nd of August 2023. According to the law, before the expiry of the franchisee can continue to adjust the toll upwards at any time. The government will explore with the operator of the West Harbour Crossing West Harbour Council to consider providing subsidies so the people use that tunnel can pay a lower toll. We will not rule the possibility that we may reach an agreement with the operator of the Western Harbour Crossing. Having considered the preliminary analysis, we are putting forward the following framework. We want to take this up with the transport panel and other stakeholders so that we can come up with the toll adjustment option that will satisfy public aspirations. There are altogether 7. First of all, the proposed option should not just cover individual tunnels. Of the 3 cross-harbour tunnels, 15 of them would use, of the users will also use the tunnels linking up Kowloon and Sha Tin. Furthermore, we must also consider how we can make use of the spare the capacity of the Western Harbour Tunnel, the Takesnes and the Sha Tin Heights Tunnel in order to relieve the congestion in the other tunnels. And the adjustment of the toll should cover all the 6 tunnels. If we fail to reach an agreement with the Western Harbour Crossing, then we will consider covering all 5 tunnels. Secondly, we should not waive the tolls for the tunnels, because if we waive all the tolls, it will generate more additional demand for using the tunnel, and this will further exceed the capacity. Furthermore, there will be serious congestion and thus adversely affecting the roads which link up with the tunnel on either side of the harbour. Thirdly, adjust the tolls for the Cross Harbour Tunnel and the Lion Rock Tunnel, because the two are most centrally located, it's most convenient, and also the tolls are cheaper than the other tolls, and therefore there is no room for any downward adjustment. For the Lion Rock Tunnel and the Cross Harbour Tunnel during the morning peak hours, the capacity is already exceeded by 77% and 35% respectively, but for the other tunnels, they have not yet exceeded the capacity. I'm sorry, I made a mistake just now. For the Cross Harbour Tunnel and the Lion Rock Tunnel, it's the capacity is exceeded by 77% and 35%.
Fourth, the toll adjustment should focus primarily on private cars, taxis, and motorcycles, because private cars, taxis, and motorcycles contribute to about 73% of the total tunnel traffic volume. So if we adjust the tolls for these vehicles, that will help in redistribute the traffic. And in the past 10 years, the annual growth rate of motorcycles and private cars amounted to about 4%. And also motorcycles occupy space on the traffic lane within the tunnel. As for lorries or goods vehicles, we see that if we are to increase the toll for goods vehicles, that would in turn increase the transportation costs and will cause an adverse impact on the logistics industry, and the cost will be passed on to consumers. Fifth, we would not the tolls on fixed route public transport should not be increased. We all understand that these public transport run on fixed routes, and the adjusting their tolls will not have an adjustment impact on the traffic flow. Fourth, we would be looking at differential toll levels at different periods, maybe explored. Maybe we should be charging different toll levels on weekdays and Sundays, and if we would be charging different tolls at different time periods on weekdays may cause some motorists to speed up and have safety concerns, and we have to look at the operational issues resulted. Seventh, we should look at the toll adjustment mechanisms. We have to regularly adjust the tolls to redistribute traffic. We will adopt some objective factors, for example, the increase and decrease in the traffic demand, and also the average time spent on going through the tunnels. We need to come up with legislative proposals to adjust the tolls. And the way forward, we will take into account members' views and other stakeholders' views to come up with different toll adjustment options and further assess the impact of the proposals on tunnel traffic. And within this legislative year, we will consult the transport panel on our concrete or specific legislative proposals, and we have forged a consensus within the community where we implement the toll adjustment proposals. So much for my presentation. As I said, I will extend the meeting time for 15 minutes to 1 p.m. 15 members are in the queue. If we have 4 minutes and we won't have enough time, I have two choices. If you agree, maybe I can extend the meeting for another 15 minutes till 1:15 p.m. The other option is to limit your speaking time to 3 minutes. Any views, any objection to further extension? So we'll end the meeting at 1:15. Thank you very much. Okay, 4 minutes each for members. I will have to reserve some time to deal with the motions. First is Mr. Chen Hanban. 4 minutes. Well, please stay within the time limit. The government is proposing this is just an expedient measure by coming with a study. Way back, you resume the earlier tunnel, and then you have these three options, and now you have taken back the TCT, and you are coming up with these rationalization study. Well, maybe you should also consider the Tai Lam Tunnel this time as well. Now, there should, well, among the different tunnels, there are three groups, then two in each. And we can, well, the Route 8K and WHC can serve to diversion purposes. For WHC, during the peak hours, there is congestion. It won't serve to redistribute the traffic. Only more congestion will be seen. And in the New Town Plaza, the access is always congested. And as a result, there has been a low utilization rate of Route 8K or Eagle's Nest Tunnel. So if we want to use these two tunnels to serve a diversion purpose, we must clear the traffic congestion there first. And also, you must also factor in the Central Wan Chai bypass. If you go through Route 8K and you want to go to Island East, they won't use that. But if there is the CWB commissioned, vehicles can consider travel through Route 8K and then WHC to go to eastern part of the island. So there are some prerequisites for doing that. I don't know whether the government has plans to make available these prerequisite conditions. And I think a more feasible approach is to have toll reduction. We have $65 for private vehicles in WHC. It's already very expensive. If you increase the toll further, does it mean that people will not use the tunnel? No. $65 is a very high fee. And still, so many private vehicles have opted for WHC. So, if you try to have toll increase to cut down on the number of vehicles, that won't work. And so I would like to ask the government. You said that you plan to reduce the toll for WHC. What is the level you're talking about? How attractive is it going to be? And if we talk about traffic redistribution, well, please don't try to bargain with the WHC company by using your trip as a franchise to get them lower their toll. So we have 16 members who would like to answer a question. I have to draw a line there. Government. Mr. Chen, thank you for your question. Well, why are we not including some of the channels in this study? Because we want to ease the congestion of the RHC, and we think that the three land tunnels and the RHCs are congested, and we're focusing that on that in our study. And if we can forge a consensus on this study, then we can consider including other channels in the study as well. Now, for Sha Tin congestion, well, there has been congestion in Sha Tin, and the TD and the CEDD have implemented a number of road improvement measures to help alleviate congestion in Sha Tin, including had a Sha Tin section of Taipo Road. That would be road widening works from Fo Tan to Sha Tin Hengshui Road. The two-way dual lane will be expanded to three-lane dual-way carriageway. We will have management measures at the road conjunctions, and that covers Tai Chung Kiu Road, Sha Tin Road. We will improve on the road signages, we'll adjust the traffic lights, we will relocate the bus stops. As for the coordination with the WHC, we have an open attitude. We have started a dialogue with them, And we have heard Mr. Chen's views. We will consider them in our negotiations. What is the amount of subsidy that you're talking about? You don't have a proposal yet. We have some preliminary contact with them. At the moment, we don't have any specific figures to give. Mr. Jeremy Tan, on the issue of RHC, I would like to say something about taxis. Now, for CHT, well, actually, it is used by mainly private cars to a tune of 17 million cars each year. And for taxis, 9.7 million in number, so it's a huge sum. So it's more a problem with the taxis on their return trip. Now, for the three RHCs, normally passengers have to pay for the return trip as well. Now, for CHT, it's $10, EHC, WHC, $15 in return trip. Now, for WHC, for a return trip payment, it's $65. So, taxis will actually go mainly through CHT to get to the other side of the harbour. So as a result, CHT is very congested, and the connecting roads around CHT are also congested. And taxis also will be waiting for passengers around the neighboring areas of CHT, for example, in Hong Ham on the Kowloon side, and Wan Chai and Causeway Bay on the island side. Taxis are unlike private cars. Private cars have a certain destination to reach, but for empty taxis, they don't have a fixed destination. Their only goal is to get to the other side of the harbour. So in the long term, should we be coming up with measures to discourage taxis from returning to the other side of the harbour after a cross-harbour trip? That's not very healthy, the situation that we are seeing. And then we are creating unnecessary congestion on the roads because they are the empty taxis are crossing the CHT to get to the other side of the harbour, and that takes up the tunnel space unnecessarily. So can the government consider averaging out the fares for return trips for taxis among the three tunnels? So that can help redistribute the traffic among the three RHC, and they can also ease the congestion around the connecting roads around the three RHCs. And also passengers will be convenient because they don't have to gather at certain areas to get across to the other side of the harbour. Yes, thank you for your very good, valuable view. We have heard you clearly on that point. We are willing to listen to stakeholders' views later on. We will be coming up with toll framework, and we will communicate with the stakeholders, including the taxis trade. I would like to say something about buses too. Now, for franchised buses, you will not adjust the toll for them. I think you can waive the toll altogether. And the amount of saved will be plowed back to the destinate, to the fixed route. Now, if the amount saved can be used for the designated route, then the passengers on that route can save, say, $1 to $2. Don't let them plow back the amount saved into the large book. Would the government consider waiving the toll for the public buses so that more people are encouraged to take public transport? Thank you, Mr. Tan, for your question or comment. There is a certain mechanism for bus fares, but tunnel tolls make up a small part of their costs. We will consider Mr. Tam's views and we will give you a reply duly. Dr. Pokake, right now for WHC during the peak hours, it's not that smooth. I mean, the traffic, whether it's going from Hong Kong to Kowloon or the other way around, once you get to the connecting roads, it's quite congested. The CWB will be commissioned in 2019. I don't know whether it's the middle or later that year, and the WHC will be vested in the government in 2023. And I can't see the government implementing the toll adjustment before 2019. What is interesting is that it will talk to the WHC company. The statutory toll for private cars is 225, taxis is 225, medium goods vehicles 490, heavy goods vehicles 680. Now, well, if the government is going to give me subsidy, then I will charge the statutory tolls. And that's a very unwise way of doing it. Unless the WHC that you would be giving a subsidy based on, say, the existing level fee, $25 or $65. I don't know how you're going to do it. There are so many uncertain factors involved, and you will be the government can take over the company in 2023. We spent $40 billion on the CWB, and we spent $6.5 billion on building the WHC, and they've already collected tolls for some 20 years. So can the government advance the timetable of taking over the WHC and try to close the gaps in the fees among the three RHCs? I don't agree increasing the tolls for the other two RHCs, because in fact a lot of commercial vehicles are using these two tunnels. And if you are going to decrease the toll for private cars and motorcycles, I don't think that's reasonable. If you reduce the toll, you are not encouraging people to take public transport. You should rather reduce the toll for taxis, PLBs, and buses. And if that is done, the government can ask the operators to reduce the fare. As a result, people are induced to take public transport. So can the government respond to these questions? Can you advance the time of taking over the WHC? We have some initial contact with the WHC on the subsidy arrangements, and we are now in discussion on that. And for the time being, we just have some preliminary contact, and we haven't had any plan to buy back the tunnel company.
Yes. Well, according to our consultancy report, if we were to charge a zero toll, sorry, Chairman, I didn't say that we should, you know, waive all the toll charges. To effectively reduce the traffic volume, we need to increase the toll. You've not answered my question. My question is that for the public transport like PLB and buses, why don't you subsidize them? You should not be subsidizing the private vehicles and the motorcycle users. We've only made a preliminary contact with the operator of the WHC. We don't have any specific options worked out yet. This is only a preliminary, contact. So having heard members, we've heard members here, we can certainly take this back and explore it further with the operator of the WHC. We also found out that 75% of the tunnels are used. So I think if we could increase the traffic flow, it can help improve the traffic situation. If you were to lower the toll, how many more vehicles will be attracted to use the WHCs? I think our assessment is based on a mathematical model, and we will take on board the views of stakeholders, and then we will then come up with a specific proposal for the committee to come up with a better assessment. I'm worried that you will end up attracting more people to use the tunnel and thus further aggravating the congestion. Michael Tien, Chairman. In Hong Kong, we have limited land and lots of people and vehicles. During the peak hours, I think the average vehicle speed on the road is down by 30% in the last 10 years. I always joke that for another 10 years, all the vehicles will be on standstill on the roads. And now you're exploring, electronic road pricing. For the multi-story car parks, it's even more ludicrous, ridiculous, because we're seeing fewer and fewer, we're having fewer and fewer of these car parks. So I have a question for the experts. Of the three cross-harbour tunnels, the toll for private vehicles, it's about $110 in total. I've talked to many transport experts. They told me that if this aggregate sum were drastically reduced in future, certainly there will be so many private vehicles using the tunnel that there will be congestion at both ends of the tunnel, and the average unit speed will eventually drop to zero. So people who suggest that we should, you know, cut or drop or even waive the toll, I'm really shocked by that suggestion. But if you were to increase the toll to more than $110, you'll be under so much political pressure that you wouldn't be able to bear. So I think the best option is to, you know, let it stay at $110. In that case, I'm all in favor that eventually, I'm talking about private vehicles first, it should be that we should focus on rationalization. So, I mean, what I'm suggesting may offend many drivers but I have to speak, you know, from my conscience. For the East Harbour Crossing and the WHC, especially after the Central Wan Chai bypass is completed, these two tunnels in future, I think the East, the Cross Harbour Tunnel toll should be higher than that of the Western Harbour Tunnel. So most people who cross the harbour, I think what I have in mind, and I've talked to the expert, that eventually, anyway, the aggregate toll should be 110. Most expensive for the Eastern Harbour Cross Harbour Tunnel, followed by the Western Harbour Crossing, and then the cheapest would be the Eastern Harbour Crossing. I think you're the experts. You know, you should know the figures very well. Regarding my preliminary proposal, that is, the aggregate toll should not be less than $110. Should not be more than $110. And that it should be distributed, between the western and eastern end. What are your views on that? Well, the two of them are Mr. Chen. Well, I hope the expert will answer my question. I understand that they've conducted a study on this for a long time. He's the expert who does all the practical research. I don't care about the theories and whether it's politically feasible. Thank you, Mr. Tim, for the question. You said you regarding $110, you're talking about the toll for private vehicles, the aggregate of charge by the street tunnels. I think this is a very preliminary, idea. If the toll were packed, the aggregate were packed at 110, how do you spread out the traffic? You're talking about how to spread out the traffic volume. Right. Of course, this is not the only way to change the demand or how you can spread out the traffic, because there are other vehicles as well, and also our traffic model will also, have to be considered. So you are putting forward some very simple concepts. Of course you can, you agree, okay. Claudia Mo, thank you. First of all, I must criticize the government because you, once every few years, you spend a lot of public funds to engage consultants to the tune of tens of millions of dollars to come up with this report on the usage of our tunnels. But we're getting the same answers each and every time. None of this is new for us. And now you're asking us to discuss how we can rationally use our tunnels. And you say that you must satisfy public aspirations. Fine. But you've actually set a limit to what you want us to discuss. You already stated clearly that you will be, you have preliminary discussion with the operator of the WHC, and then you will decide next the way forward. And you're saying that you must give them a subsidy before we even have a discussion. But the WHC franchise have 6 more years before it expires. I think the you know, shorter the time before the franchise expire, the lower the value of the tunnel. So why is it that you're still not considering to buy back the tunnel? We've talked about this many times and you've not considered that. And in your framework, you've not included this option, period. You only talk about subsidies. If you're only talking about subsidizing public transport, well, of course, this has been done before. You need to do that for ferries. The rationale is that the ferries don't have enough patronage. They are incurring losses. Without a subsidy, that the ferry operator will simply quit. So you have a small number of people who need to ride on these ferries, there will be a serious impact. That is a very strong justification. We're talking about public interest, but it's not the case for the WHC. It's totally unreasonable. Now, you say that you are now talking to the WHC. Other than a subsidy, would you consider a buyback? We have reserved to the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars. The government shouldn't be able to afford it. Undersecretary, are you going to buy back the WHC? Buyback is not one of the options that we're not considering. I'm asking you why. I'm not the first one to raise this question. I won't be the last. There are six more years before the franchise expires. Undersecretary? Deputy Secretary? Thank you, Ms. Mo, for the question. I think I want the committee to focus our discussion on the toll rationalization proposal in order to relieve the traffic congestion. Chairman, I must interrupt here. This is unfair. He set the framework for our discussion. He's now telling us that under this framework, they have not considered the option of buying back the WHC. Isn't that disrespectful of this council? Chairman, if I may continue, our present discussion is that we want to rationally distribute the traffic of the three tunnels. So for people who don't use the WHC, we hope that by adjusting the tolls for the CHT, we can rationalize the usage. So it's not absolutely necessary that people must use the tunnel. Some people are saying that if we buy back the WHC, the problem will be resolved. I must point out that buyback and the subsidy, whether it's for both options, we need to do our sums. Some members say that if we were to give a subsidy, then the WHC will charge a statutory toll. The same logic applies to a buyback scenario. And we need to also consider the asset value of the WHC, and we have to agree on that first. And this would make the negotiation even more complicated. But you're not even going to, I'm asking whether you can discuss that. Our purpose is to make proper use of public funds and to enable the users of tunnels to ensure that the traffic will be better, distributed. We want to have a simpler discussion rather than. So you're saying it's too complicated, that's why you're not going to discuss that. Well, I think your time is up and we may yet have to discuss this further. Mr. Chen Chung-ying, the sixth option is that you can explore charging different tolls at different periods, and this is commonly used in other countries, but for Sundays and public holidays, you can experiment with different tolls. But Sundays and public holiday is not the time we need to, rationalize the traffic flow. So if you really were to do that, you would simply encourage people to either use or not use the tunnels on Sundays and public holidays. It doesn't affect the situation on weekdays. But members have always been suggesting that during the peak hours and on peak hours, there should be different charges. The government said that at different time periods, the government is worried that it may result in traffic accidents as drivers try to manipulate the different hours. Are there any other examples in other jurisdictions to prove that this is the case? Would you consider a longer buffer period? For example, during the peak hour, you can have longer peak hours so that when the traffic volume is slowed down, is reduced, only then would you, implement the non-peak hours session. if we have different fees for different tolls for peak and non-peak hours, do we need to have a cut-off line? Once you have a cut-off line, inevitably drivers would like to pay less, and they would delay, slow down their vehicle, or they may speed up the vehicle. In some other countries which have applied electronic road pricing, the drivers would exploit the buffer period. If the toll, you know, will not be reduced from $20 to $10, you will reduce the toll, you know, several minutes, you adjust it by $1, so that you will have progressively lowered the toll. So that people who want to deliberately avoid the expensive toll, they will have less incentive to do that. But in Hong Kong, we do not have electronic road pricing yet. So we may need to explore this proposal at the next stage. Chairman, you could do that easily instead. You can set the toll at $30 and then followed by $28, $26, $24, $22. And you can lower the toll once every 20 minutes. So I don't think he's answered my first question satisfactorily. Secondly, on subsidizing the WHC, the government always applied two concepts, cost recovery and user pay. For the WHC, according to the information they disclose, we know what are their operating costs. For the other five tunnels, the government has never given us the financial information. Could we, you know, of the profits that we made of the other five tunnels, we can then decide how much subsidy we can give to the WHC, which is privately owned. Could we be given a better picture? We do have figure in respect of the other government tunnels. I know you do. Are you able to disclose them? It's put on to our website already. We can certainly provide the data to Mr. Chen after the meeting. I'm sure you... I'd like to... Mr. Kwong Chun Yu, I've already drawn the line earlier, and we don't have really have time. So I'm sorry. Mr. Lau Kwok Fun, thank you. The proposal to rationalize the traffic flow of the six tunnels, I think the whole idea is to try to relieve the congestion. In that case, I think there are at least three blind spots which the consultant has overlooked.
The first blind spot has to do with the Tai Lam Tunnel. You should include that. You said that Tai Lam may not be related to RLT connecting Sha Tin to Kowloon. Well, you think that then that you are out of touch with reality. If I want to use a CHD, I will use RLT. If I want to use WHC, I would use a Route 8K or Tai Lam. So, well, Tai Po and North District also drivers also go through Sha Tin. So if you include Tai Lam Tunnel as well, then you can encourage North District motorists can use WHC and Tai Lam Tunnel to go to the other side of the harbour. And many bus routes are really doing that, and they prove to be very popular. Although the distance is longer, but the congestion is less. You have to look at the situation of the roads. I am all against increasing toll for LRT. Even if you increase the toll for LRT, people would not turn to Route 8K instead of using LRT. If I have to use Route 8K, I have to go through the section near Sha Tin New Town Plaza, and it's very congested. So I would not give up on LRT just because there is a toll increase, and I would opt for Route 8K. That would not be the case. That is the second blind spot that you have. You have not looked at the actual situation on the roads. The third blind spot is that tolls on fixed route public transport would not be increased. You should encourage more people to take buses. Now you have got three blind spots. You are just proposing short-term measures to ease the congestion. I have come up with this report myself. I have a 34-page report proposing medium, short, and long-term measures to improve the situation. Say, for example, if you cross the harbour by CHT and also use LRT. If you use standardize the route fare, that the toll. Now for the WHC, the bus fare can go can be reduced by $1.40. If you standardize the tolls for the three land tunnels, TCT, there can be a fare cut of 30 cents. And for Thailand, there can be a $1.4 a cut. So if I take two routes, then for every journey, I can save on $3. So if you can do that, you can drive the bus fares down and people will be encouraged to use more public transport. Second, the government said that there have been road widening works at Sha Tin section of Tai Po Road, and it's called the 7861TH project. You should seek funding from FC as soon as possible, because of that, the congestion of that section, a lot of people will not opt for Route 8K. And we should also widen the connecting roads to TCT, and in the long term, you should build a Sha Tin bypass leading from Ma Liu Shui, go through the hills and take people directly to Eagle's Nest, so that the North District drivers can be encouraged to use Eagle's Nest. And I will be talking to you about my report later on in a meeting with you. Please accept my proposal. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to explore several points with the Undersecretary. First, the government is ruling options other than toll adjustment. But why are you doing that? You didn't tell us. They have ruled out. Well, that would be the commissioning of the Cheung Kwan Long Lam Tin Stage Tunnel in 2021. And then this ERP system will be in place in that tunnel. So there will be no toll collection plaza in this tunnel. This will be the first time that this will be done in Hong Kong. But in this paper, the government is ruling out the possibility of cancelling the toll collection plaza for the six tunnels, and whether there will be any impact on the traffic flow as a result of that. The government said that they will not look into that. They don't anticipate that there will be great impact on the traffic flow. Now, because the toll collection plazas are very often the bottlenecks in the entire traffic flow, and the congestion happens all the time at the two ends, the two toll collection plazas at the two different ends of the tunnel, and it will affect the traffic flow. But the paper does not delve into this. I hope that you can add that in. Second, if you can demolish the toll collection plaza, then we can give priority to public transport at CHD. The congestion problem there, half of the problem comes from the fact that public transport have to go into these toll collection plaza areas to drop off and pick up passengers. And if we do away with the collection plaza and we use that space for as a shortcut for the buses, then for them to pick up and drop off passengers, that can help alleviate the traffic situation in central Kowloon. And there will be better distribution of traffic among the six tunnels as a result. Well, you should give priority to public transport, and if you give more space at the CHT toll plaza area to public transport, then that works better. And thirdly, the paper is silent on the demands for traffic demands. And you just focus on the money. You say the fares will determine how the motorists will opt for the different tunnels. Well, that is not the case, as pointed out by some members. The TC, the LRT and the route K, 8K, charge the same tolls. How come that the LRT gets more traffic than our route 8K? You have to look into that before you can actually solve the problem. You should not be focusing on the tolls only. And it seems that the government is just trying to pave the way for a toll increase in CHD and ETHC. That's not a fair approach. And WHC, whether we are buying back or resorting to other means to help easy to help with the situation, it has to do with the toll collection policy. You have to come with a clear policy on toll charging for the six tunnels before you decide on the way forward. I don't need them to answer. So I'd like to ask members here on this. You are given several minutes to speak. You may think that you cannot fully express your views. Do you think that we need to convene a special meeting or even hold a public hearing so that we can discuss more with the subject with the government? Support it? Yes, we will arrange. Mr. Michael Look, Chairman. Whether the infrastructure planning in Hong Kong has not been forward-looking, so that's why we are seeing problems in the tunnel situation. And it takes just, say, 10 years before all the crossings and the tunnels get saturated. And then we have to spend a lot more money to do patchwork measures to improve the situation. That's how Hong Kong infrastructure planning is like. We have to change our mindset in the future. Now, the government says the CWB's commissioning provides a good opportunity for us to improve the situation. I don't get it. The CWB's portal is far off from the WHC's portal area. It's near Shangwan. It will continue to be congested, I believe. Are there actually improvements on the connecting roads in relation to this CWB and WHC? If you don't improve on the connection roads, you are just trying to shift the congestion from one road to another. Second, I would like to find out about this traffic model that you are working on. Will all the big data be made public to all in the future? And a lot of think tanks in the community would need that kind of information to do analysis, and then you can also pull the wisdom of everybody in your plans. Also, I have also consulted the Transport and Traffic General Union. They said their inclination is that the toll of the three RHC will be standardized, or they will be closer to each other, so that the motorists can just choose the RHC based on the geographic location. They don't have to consider the tolls, so that people can be encouraged to use WHC if they think it's a shorter route, and then they will not be opting for CHD causing unnecessary traffic and congestion. I have a motion today. The government may think that if we have a toll reduction for taxis and private cars, people will be encouraged to opt for these two transport modes. But I think we should deal first with public transport, including franchised buses, PLBs and GMBs, etc. I would like to ask that if there is a toll reduction, the PLB operators and bus operators have to adjust downwards their fares. That is to say that the savings can be plowed back to the relevant bus routes so that people's burden can be alleviated. I support your toll reduction for the buses, but you must have a mechanism that they can plow back the money to the relevant routes so that the relevant passengers can benefit. Who can take that question? I would like to answer the question about the connecting roads to WHC. As we all know, the WHX traffic demand is lower than the design capacity. There is room to accommodate more traffic. But then we have the feeling that at the exit of the WHC, there is some congestion and drivers can't go through that smoothly. Because on the northern part of Ireland, the east-west trunk road is Connaught Road and Davos Road, etc. And the design capacity there is insufficient. So there is indeed congestion. At the northern shore of the Hong Kong Island, if you go from the western district to the north point, that takes up 20 to 25% of the traffic. Now, after the CWB is commissioned, these vehicles do not have to go through Connaught Road Central, which will be seeing an improvement in its traffic. So a lot more cars will be using WHC. Now, the same goes for the connecting roads near Route 8K. So members have also suggested this, and we will try to speed up the road widening works near Tai Po Road. Mr. Yu Si Wing, I don't agree to a toll reduction for the RHC. That would even be more problematic if it is toll-free. Now, you know that at the Golden Week this past year on the mainland, there's been huge traffic gridlock because the roads were made toll-free. I don't think that's necessary to have a toll reduction. Conversely, the government has made suggestions on whether we should standardize the toll of CHT and EHC, and also there should be an adjustment of the tolls at WHC. I think we should explore that. Now for CHT, the private car has to pay $20. For WHC, they have to pay $65. As a result, a lot more vehicles will go to CHT and EHC. So, and the WHC is not that saturated when it comes to usage. And I don't agree that we should standardize the toll level among the three RHCs. That means there will be a downward adjustment for WHC. And then for the difference, it must come from the government subsidy to the operator. Well, the greater is the difference in the toll, the higher is the subsidy. So we should standardize the CHT and EHC toll at, say, $25. And for WHC, the toll should go down, say, to $40. Try to narrow down on the differences in the toll levels, as pointed out by Mr. Michael Lok. And then the government doesn't have to pay such a huge amount of subsidy.
Oh. When the Hong Kong Macau Dry Bridge is commissioned, and also the XRL will be commissioned. So I think that would also increase the traffic for the WHC. So I don't think we should drastically reduce the toll to standardize the toll for the three tunnels. So I think there should be a compromise approach. I think we can experiment this for a year, and after a year's experiment, we can find out what the traffic flow is like in respect of the three tunnels. And then we can talk to the operator of the WHC about subsidy and so on. Wouldn't that be a better approach? Thank you, Mr. Yu, for your suggestion. You specifically suggest that for the CHT and the EHT, that it's supposed to be standardized at $25 and $40 for the WHC. We can certainly, you know, include this idea into the simulation model. We will try to experiment, explore the different toll proposals, and try to find out how it will impact on the traffic flow. Later on, we will report back to the committee regarding the findings of that study. Chairman, you must have some specific options before you can talk to the operator of the WHC. Now, we may discuss various options we think the government can do, but the WHC operator may has its own considerations. If you can come out with a proposal and we all have a consensus that it's feasible, then you can talk to the operator of the WHC. If they are willing to talk and negotiate, only then can we come up negotiate an option. If we all have different considerations and the end, whatever option we arrive at, they don't accept, then all the effort will be spent in vain. I'm most worried that this will even give the collusion, the impression that the government is colluding with the operator. Mr. Pan Xiuping, thank you. I think the officials have already told us that for all these tunnels, they have already exceeded the capacity. We only have 3 tunnels for the whole territory of Hong Kong. If you say that we can rely on the WHC to relieve the congestion, in previous discussion, we've always argued that the government should consider building the 4th or even the 5th Cross Harbour Tunnel. The officials told us that they have now made preliminary contact with the operator of the WHC. Personally, you want to relieve the traffic congestion by adjusting the toll. The Western Harbour Crossing is designed with a capacity of 4,200 vehicles per hour. Right now it's 3,800. We're only talking about a difference of 400 vehicles per hour. Of course, the whole arrangement is that the design, the capacity is 111,000, but now it's only 60,000. So the government is going to subsidize the WHD. Hopefully this will divert the traffic there. But I must insist that you must use public funds reasonably. So I think any subsidy should benefit all vehicles. The government is telling us that you have not reached any conclusion yet. But if the WHC refuse to negotiate with you, what are you going to do? And secondly, you say you are conducting a further study on 7 options. And you say that after talking to the WHC, you will, exchange views further with this committee during the current session. And if there is a consensus in society, you will then amend the legislation to adjust the fees. I'd like to ask you whether you have, what is your preliminary timetable? There are only a few months left for the current session. So does it mean that you already have preliminary option in mind? Thank you, Mr. Pan. Our negotiation with the WHC is a very preliminary contact only. We have only had some very simple preliminary discussions. We understand that the discussion is going to be tough. We thank Mr. Pan and Mr. Yeo for their valuable advice. As for the timetable, after our meeting today and having heard members, we will then approach the different stakeholders, including those in the transport trade, to consult them, and then we will proceed with a more detailed study and analysis. And by June or July next year, we will put forward our specific proposal to this committee and report to members. So after we reach an agreement in July, and it may take 2 or 3 more years before the legislation is finally enacted. Could somebody switch on the microphone for Ms. Law? Next year, having heard members, the views of members of other stakeholders, and in view of if we have an agreement with the operator of the WHC, then if we have any specific proposals, we'll come back to this committee in June or July next year. And with your support, the amendment to the ordinance is only a subsidiary legislation. If there is a social consensus and we have your support, I believe we can implement the proposal very soon. Mr. Eddie Ju, thank you. I have several questions. Overall, we all know that there is simply no capacity for the 3 tunnels. So I'd like to know, first of all, look at the broad picture. First of all, I'd like to go back to your PowerPoint, the projection for 2026. and the figures, or 2021. You are assuming that the growth in the number of private vehicles and motorcycles is 4% per annum. If private cars and motorcycles grow at 4% per annum, the cumulative growth will increase with 7% from 2017 to 2021. But looking at your projected traffic for the Cross Harbour tunnels, southbound and northbound, there's only an increase of 5%. So what is your assumption behind that? And secondly, coming to the PowerPoint on page 6, the Cross Harbour traffic, you have an aggregate number, 12,600 southbound, 12,200 northbound. This is your projection. If you don't anything, then that is the projected number. Now that you're proposing to do something, say the TAC's report on how to relieve traffic congestion, including the options that you are now exploring to cut down on the number of private cars and motorcycles using the tunnel. Having done all that, do you have a new target number for the total traffic volume for the Cross Harbour Tunnel? Would it be smaller? And thirdly, a related question. The 73% that is taken up by private car, taxis and motorcycles, could that be adjusted downwards? Now, who would like to take those questions? Director. To answer the first question regarding the private vehicles, we all know that the growth in the number of private vehicles has been 3 to 4% per annum. As for the growth in traffic for the tunnels, it's not as serious. Normally, we would use the traffic growth in traffic volume for the tunnels is about 1 to 2%. You are assuming that there will be continue to be 3 to 4%. For private vehicles, it's 3 to 4% per annum. But the traffic volume, the increase in traffic volume for the tunnel is only 1 to 2%. Whether we have a target, that's your other question. So far, we don't have a target for the total traffic flow. But when we carry out our traffic assessment, our purpose is that we want to cut down on the time spent by drivers crossing using the tunnel. What about the 70%? That only reflects the present situation. We don't have any target in mind. But one of our framework points out that because private cars, taxis, and motorcycles take up about a high percentage of the traffic volume in the tunnels, and that's why we are targeting or focusing on these categories of vehicles. I'd like to ask the Bureau whether for this preliminary assessment, could you give us the full text of this, including the numbers, so that we have more details before we have the public hearing? For these preliminary data, they have been prepared by our consultant. They have not yet been, collated. But after we've gone through the consultation, we will come up with a proposal. For the proposed tolls. After that, we will conduct a more detailed study, and then I'm saying that whatever data they have, they should give them to us. We want to see whether or not they've done the sums right. We also have our experts on our side. I understand, I understand, but I don't think the data that they have now don't really have much reference value. Well, the projected targets and so on, how they arrive at these numbers are very important. Could you give us your assumptions? I think Mr. Ju can go back to the figures in slide number 5 or 6. These are based on the present traffic flow. The 73%, for example, is based on the current traffic situation. We can certainly provide such data. I'm sorry you don't have more time. Dr. Cheng Chong Tan. I don't understand why they cannot give us the data. If you say that there's some of the data you're still, you know, working on. But if that's the case, how does the government arrive at the present scenario or proposal? Is it that you've only arrived at a conclusion before you ask the consultant to help you collect the data to sort of justify your proposal? It's not logical. How is it that while your data is not ready, you already have an option before us? I'd like to go back to option 13. Zero toll will generate more additional traffic demand for the tunnels, and then it will be oversaturated. So you must have come to this conclusion based on some data. Where is such data? Mr. Ji is asking exactly this. Could you give us the raw data? We'll take a look at the data to see whether or not what you're saying is right. Just in this respect, why is it that you have ruled out the option of zero toll? Let me answer the question regarding the model based on which we made our projections. It's a two-stage study. I think Mr. Chen will understand the meaning of two-stage. It's a two-stage estimation. In stage one, we are using the present data, and we've adjusted the traffic model to forecast the impact of the various options. For the predicted option, Then we need to make an assessment for stage two. In stage two, for all the options we have chosen, we'll conduct different assessment, including detailed traffic impact study, environmental impact, etc., etc. That is the approach we've taken for the study. Mr. Cheng, I think for the first stage, we want to listen to members' views so that we can proceed to the second stage. In the second stage, we will prepare the specific options, and then we will understand your explanation, the steps that you've taken for your study. But this is the conclusion of a study. I'd like to point out that the consultant has given us this advice, that if we, you know, waive all the tolls, it will result in, you know, congestion. So regarding the price flexibility, you're assuming that if there's no toll, people who originally wanted to take public transport would now drive instead. That is one of your assumptions, right? At the same time, if you waive the tolls, the buses, the taxis don't have to pay tolls. So it's zero toll across the board. So how do you arrive at that flexibility which you're assuming?
So, Chairman, so on what basis and on what data did you arrive at this conclusion? I am making a very constructive suggestion here. Some members said that for seed HD, we should, they would like to focus to work on taxis and private cars. And how come that you are granting zero toll to buses, but if you do that, members will ask you to urge the bus car operators to cut their fares, bus fares. So what is the formula? So we don't know how the mechanism is going to be like. And by 2030, the six tunnels will be owned by the government. Shouldn't we treat them as public assets and resources, and then there should be toll-free arrangement and everybody can enjoy the use of these tunnels? So there, would you be considering the price elasticity aspect? You will try to use the price to encourage people to go there and not to discourage people to go there. Dr. Helena Wong, for the WHC, it says that the southbound in the morning peak hours, there is no queue, traffic queue. I use the WHC every morning. I'm not traveling on the very peak hour. At 10 a.m., is also congested at the very right lane, because that leads to Central and Shangwan, and that lane is the most congested one. You can consider measures to redistribute the traffic, but then it's congested now, but your paper says it's otherwise, so you've been giving us some wrong information. If you said that you will have a toll reduction of WHC and a toll increase of CHD, as a result, there will even be more congestion on WHC. So as a result, all the RHCs will get congested. It's a matter of the degree of congestion. So I don't think your proposals will resolve the problems. How come that what we're experiencing is different from what is shown on your data? Are your data outdated or what? Second, there is a strong demand for going to Central Kowloon. We have 4,600 vehicles using in the peak hour, and the design capacity is only 2,600. Would you consider studying at LRT and CHT, provide for one more lane, and rebuild the original tunnel system to cope with the traffic volume? Maybe you can provide for a three-lane tunnel there to increase the capacity. Of course, we have to at the same time deal with the connecting roads before and after crossing the harbour. Is there room to study into the feasibility of that? I'll try to answer the two questions. In our paper, we said that the WHC has a traffic demand of 90% of the capacity, and we don't rule out that at certain periods there might be a slight congestion. And the member mentioned about the exit at the Western District. We noticed that there is a problem because of the road situation there. Every day our traffic control colleagues will try to make adjustments to the traffic lights there to try to ease the congestion at the exit of the WHC there. That's number one. Number two, can we add an extra lane on CHT or our LRT? If we are to add another lane, I think it's difficult to find space to do that. We can study in the long term, though. A member also mentioned that even though we've been able to find space to provide an additional lane, there is another problem with the capacity of the connecting roads. That's something that we have to look into as well. In fact, we can imagine if we are to build another lane in CHT leading to Causeway Bay, would there be space around Causeway Bay to accommodate that? I believe that all of us have an answer. Have you conducted any studies like that? Now, the planning department is now working on this 2030 plus planning study, and they have mapped out the long-term land use plans, and after that we will also be mapping out a long-term study on road use in Hong Kong, and then we can look into that to see if there is room for us to do that. Ms. Tanya Chan, now this time we're already looking again at the toll rational study. This time around we have included three land tunnels. When I last served as the electrical member, we have already looked at this issue. In 2008, we have engaged a consultant to come up with a study, which is completed in 2010, and it was introduced to the electrical, and we discussed that. And I still have the papers with us. And from 2010 to 2011, we conducted a three-month consultation. We came up with the three options. And after that, we continued to have public consultation. And after the public consultation, it was decided that we would put on hold the proposal to increase the toll for CHT and decrease the toll for EHC. So, and we spent 5 years on this, and we were talking about buying back the EHC at that time, and the EHC was handed back to the government in 2016 already. I don't know what we will end up after this study, and we're now in 2017, and we'll take over WHC in 2023. So what are you going to discuss with them? You seem to be procrastinating. You said that you have a preliminary study, as well the Undersecretary said that will be a first phase and there will be a second phase, and then that you will consult the trade and there will be public consultation. And then maybe that will drag on for 5 years and we will be taking over, taking back the WHC in 2023. Now in 2013 and 14, Professor Anthony Zhang, after so many rounds of public consultation, decided that we would not adopt the proposal of toll increase for CHT and toll reduction for EHC. Now you have already some inclination here this time round in your study. And I would like to ask whether you are totally ignoring what Professor Zhang was suggesting. So once in every few years, you conduct a study and then you will try to come up with proposals. We keep on doing the same exercise over and over. Will we be coming up with a conclusion? Will anything be done in the end? In 2013, after some studies, the government had come up with three options on toll increase for CHT and toll reduction for EHC. We tried to redirect traffic away from CHT, but as the EHC's traffic flow has increased, the district council and the residents there have expressed their worries. They said that if that is done, the Kuntong bypass and other connecting roads will get worsened. And in 2014 February, the government decided to put in abeyance such proposals. And now the government's thinking is after the CWB has been commissioned, the connecting roads around the WHC will see its congestion being eased, and there will be residual capacity at the connecting roads near WHC. And then by then, we will be coming up with a toll rationalization plan for the three RHCs. So there were indeed factors that have been taken on board when we considered shelving the proposal back in 2013. I understand that I've been a resident and also a district councillor of Hong Kong Island. Well, the CWB should have been commissioned this year, and now it will be postponed to 2018-19 as set out in the paper. But I don't get it. You've been repeating your exercises over and over. Have you considered building another cross road harbour crossings? Well, as we said, we would have a 2030 plus study, as we understand. Of the eastern to western corridor in Hong Kong is already very congested, Mr. Raymond Chan. First of all, I think the information of in the government papers is too sketchy. So Mr. Eddie G has asked for a full report of the consultant study for reference, but then the government seems not willing to do it, and they seems to be saying that there is not a full report, so to speak. And whatever you have on hand, please give it to us. You have to do it. And the chairman, you said that their data may not be of reference. I beg to differ. Well, you have taken reference from certain things, and you may have certain assumptions and so on. I will be discussing those with you. You said that if there is a toll-free arrangement for all three tunnels, then there would be extra demand. Does it mean that people will not go to work if they have to work if there is a toll-free arrangement? And maybe people who originally take a bus will drive instead. So what is your assumption? You have to tell us. And maybe I may not be able to read through the full text. I would particularly like to have details on the preliminary assessment made by the consultant. Can you provide more details on that assessment? You said that after the preliminary assessment, the suggestions A to E will not be effective. And then you ask us to look at Annex 5. Annex 5 is just a simple picture or a simple table here. So can you respond to that first? Mr. Raymond Chen, thank you for your question. You said you refer to the preliminary assessment. As I said, this is a two-stage study, and that will adopt a transport model. We will do analysis and make projections. We have to fit in certain parameters to assess the accuracy of the model, and that we will look at factors like population distribution, income distribution, traveling habits, etc. And we go through a four-stage process, and then we come up with the framework and the first stage assessment. And today, we'd like to hear views from members before we proceed to the second stage assessment. We do have a framework so that we can focus on the on how the different scenarios can help with the redistribution of traffic volume. So at the first stage, we will be using raw data. So that's why we said that we have this preliminary assessment highlighting the relevant conclusions. I would not like to have a full set of the raw data, but I would like to have how you information how you did your assessment. How can I assess whether assess your conclusions on the suggestions A to E, and how can I assess your conclusion that zero toll will induce more demand? So if we have a public hearing, then people will be expressing all sorts of views which you have heard before. So how can we take forward this discussion? It will be very difficult. So this is my concern. The government proposes to increase the toll for CHT and LRT, and the toll and there will be a toll reduction for WHC to encourage people to use that tunnel. Now, we are concerned about TCT and in Annex C for morning. Oh, sorry, I wasn't able to finish. So thank you, members. Well, because of time constraint, I have to stop you. And I have checked there aren't enough members in this complex. So Mr. Luk Chung Hong's motion and Ms. Tanya Chen's amendment motion will be dealt with in the next meeting. And why I said that the data from the government are not of good reference? I said that because the government officials are here today to listen to our views. And I hope that the public hearing can be held as soon as possible so that the relevant factors have to be input into your model for testing. And I think the by then, the data and the assumptions will be very important. But at this stage, we are still at a very, very preliminary stage. And many different members have floated different scenarios today. And I think the government should incorporate those into your model for testing. And you should not just confining yourselves to the seven parameters you have set out in the paper. So in the interest of time, I'll deal with the motions next time. So let's get on to the next item. AOB. I don't have any AOB. All right. Thank you for attending the meeting.